Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the MPS Limited earnings conference call. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone telephone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Rahul Arora. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Good morning, everyone from New York. Welcome to the MPS Q1 FY22 earnings call. I hope everyone is staying safe and getting closer to being completely vaccinated. At MPS, nearly 70% of our associates have been vaccinated with at least one dose of a COVID-19 vaccine, either through private means or through the vaccination camps MPS has organized. In our opening segment today, I will discuss our consolidated performance in Q1. Then, Robin Blakely, Chief Operating Officer at MPS North America, will discuss how our educational publishing business has seen transformative growth over the past 15 months, and she will also focus on key developments. And then, Sukhwan Singh, Senior Vice President, who has recently taken additional ownership of our e-learning operations in India, will update us on the MPS Interactive business. They will then circle back to me and I will provide updates on platform business before we open the call to questions. Before we begin, I would once again like to thank you and extend my gratitude to the MPS Board of Directors, shareholders, and the investor community in general for their vote of confidence and support in the successful transition of leadership from first to second generation and my appointment as Chairman and CEO of MPS. Quite serendipitously, the business performance in Q1 sets us up for a robust year ahead and confirms that MPS has genuinely entered a thriving phase of business expansion. Our FX adjusted revenues in Q1 were just shy of 118 crores, which is 43.4% above previous year, while absolute PBT growth was similar to 52% compared to Q1 of last year, reflecting some margin expansion. My top three takeaways from this past quarter include, firstly, Highwire contributed the most toward the group's profitability in absolute terms across our business units. Second, MPS North America and North Books, which is MPS North America's backend in India, grew at a phenomenal double-digit clip. And finally, all lines of business were healthy and profitable, including the e-learning business, where not only did the India entity do well, but TopSim in Germany also made an unprecedented start to the financial year. I'll now hand it over to Robin to shed some light on the educational publishing practice.
Thanks, Rahul. The educational publishing practice came out of the gate in Q1 with a very strong quarter. The successful start of both the U.S. and Indian teams led to a revenue increase of 35% as compared to Q1 of last year. This success is largely due to a collaborative and seamless approach to our global services. Functional and subject matter expertise is provided by our U.S.-based offices with expertise frequently organized, operationalized from our India-based facilities. The ongoing day-to-day communication and knowledge transfer between onshore and offshore teams has led to successful global integration. During the last 15 months, we've seen an unprecedented growth in the educational publishing practice, with the increase of business on both the revenue and profitability side. We've been able to strengthen our position as a market leader in the space by both expanding our customer base and building additional volume with existing customers, all while vendor consolidation has been happening across the publishing landscape. With the dependency on the state adoption cycles for the US K-12 education sector, we continue to focus on expanding our client base to include publishers in the global market, as well as those focused on adult-based education, high school equivalency, and employability skills. That said, there are large opportunities headed our way this fiscal year due to upcoming math and science adoptions looming. We're also seeing a lot of growth in the higher education content development space as we increase the scope of our services with existing key clients. Sukhwant, over to you.
Thank you, Robin, and hi, everyone. So MPS Interactive made a strong, profitable start to financial year 22, though our expectations on revenues continue to be higher than the run rate in quarter one. On the revenue side, we grew primarily due to addition of new clients in North America and two of our top 10 accounts did much better than expected, each contributing significantly this quarter. On the expenses side, we are unlocking the learnings associated with operational efficiencies on the content side of our business and are already seeing some early positive results. While North America continues to be the largest market for MPS Interactive, we secured some great business in Australia, Singapore, and the Middle East this past quarter. The opportunity pipeline is at its highest in 2 years, and the order book is also at a much better place than the same time last year, or even last quarter for that matter. Our aspiration for the rest of the financial year is to step up revenues and also expand margins further as revenue increases through enhanced operational efficiency. We would also like to continue to further augment on the marketing momentum. Thanks, and over to you, Rahul.
Thanks, Robin. Thank you, Sukwan. I will now share an update on our platform business. As per the segment results, the profitability margin for the platform solution segment significantly improved from 28.44% in Q4 of last year to 34.72% in Q1 of this year. I've used the sequential quarter lens because Q1 of last year did not include Hiwire. And while revenue was down in Q1 of this year compared to Q4 of last year, this was much better than what we expected in the platform business. The incumbent business saw double-digit growth in Q1 with an increase in business from core customers. Revenues from Think also grew in double digits, primarily due to platform upgrades and professional services with existing customers. The acquisition of Hiwire has definitely helped in growing our existing incumbent platform business in the short term. Let's now open the call to some questions that can help us be better at what we do.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may please press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, you may please press star and one. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may please press star and one on their touchtone telephone. Reminder to all the participants, to ask a question, you may please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. Participants, to ask a question, you're requested to please press star and one. We will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Thank you. Participants, you're requested to please press star and one to ask a question. We have a few questions coming up in the queue now. We request you to please provide us an opportunity to promote the questions one by one. You are requested to please press star and one if you'd like to have a question, ask questions, sorry. The first question is from the line of Piyush Mehta, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hi, everyone. Congratulations for a great set of numbers this quarter, and good luck for the future as well. Just a very simple question. On the platform business, there was a shift from TopSim from platform to e-learning. So first, what's the revenue for this company? And, you know, like to like, what's the impact given this? I believe, you know, would e-learning be positive if this restated numbers were not given?
So I can take that. Thanks, Piyush. So we cannot disclose what the TopSim numbers are for competitive reasons. It's a very competitive marketplace. Having said that, as the movement has happened, the movement has also been reflected in the past quarter. So it's not that we've only changed the existing quarter numbers. But when you look at the comparables for the previous quarter, they are like to like. That's the way they've been managed. Overall, the reason for this move is because we believe, you know, TopSim, it fits closer into the e-learning segment. You know, also our chief decision maker for TopSim is part of our e-learning business. So it made more sense for us to have TopSim that we acquired through the Tata Interactive acquisition as part of our e-learning business.
Right. And on the second part, so we've done really well on the e-learning side this time, and platform business was kind of flat. And I believe that is where across the three segments, I think that is where we are looking, there's most excitement on in terms of, you know, the kind of margin that the business offers and the kind of growth that we foresee. So if you look at over the next 4 to 6 quarters, what is it something that you know, that the management sees on the platform business side?
So while we don't give, you know, quantitative forward-looking guidance, I can share some, you know, qualitative aspects. I'll also speak for a minute on the e-learning segment. On the e-learning segment, while we've done well on the profitability side, the revenue is still below our expectations, and we're expecting revenue to pick up in the rest of the year on the e-learning side. And as revenues pick up on e-learning, margins will also improve. So we're very optimistic about the e-learning business in general. Coming to the platform business, you know, the platform business really, there's two things taking place here. We have a business that we acquired that's called Hiwire, which is the bulk of the platform business. And as we know, we acquired a declining business. So that Hiwire business has still not bottomed out. It'll probably bottom out later in the year. But interestingly, what's happening is because of the acquisition of Hiwire, our existing platform business has actually started to grow in double digits because we're getting more credibility in the marketplace as a platform company. So I think this year will be, you know, on the platform side, it definitely will be, you know, a wait and watch kind of year where we have to see to what extent does the Hiwire business finally decline to, and to what extent are we able to replace that revenue with our existing platform business. And then next year, you know, we should see more stable revenue growth in the platform business. That's more on the revenue side. On the margin side, of course, there's still a lot of improvement to be done. We've made a good start in the first quarter, but we'll be looking to step it up through the end of the year.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you so much. Just one last question. On the management front, of course, we've hired some really good people. So is most of the hiring done, or are we looking to add more people on the senior side across the businesses?
Sorry, could you repeat? You didn't come across very clearly. Could you repeat your question?
My question was that we've made some really good hiring across the segments. So are we done with most of the top hirings, or are we still looking to add more people?
So we're complete from a senior management perspective. We're definitely complete. Having said that, we are looking to strengthen our people operations. So we are planning to add, you know, a VP and head of global people operations, given that we're so diverse now. So that's one position that continues to be open. And we're also looking to add some people in marketing, but that's not at the senior management level. It's more, you know, at the director level.
Great. Thank you so much and good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you. Reminder to all the participants, to ask a question, you may please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. We have the next question from the line of Anup Kulkarni from Pine Ridge. Please go ahead.
Hi, Rahul. Congrats for good set of results. Hi. So my question is regarding the our basic e-learning business. So before this restructuring of Topsy moving to e-learning, so how is that business shaping up? Is there any improvement after the pandemic? Because we were talking about corporates halting their learning operations. So have we seen any improvement in that?
Yes, we've seen, you know, as Sukwan mentioned in his opening remarks, we've seen a lot of improvement. You know, on the revenue side, we've a lot of our so as a standalone entity, the India business, you know, grew this Q1, some modest 8% type of growth on the revenue side, you know, profitability also was in double digits after a very long time. So it was nice to see that the standalone India e-learning business did well both on revenue and profit. On the revenue side, we had, you know, some of our old customers are now again waking up in terms of their, you know, learning and development needs. Additionally, we've been able to secure a lot of new logos this past year, and a lot of that business is contributing to the revenue. Having said that, while we made a very good start to the year, both on revenue and profitability, our expectations are still higher with this business. We're seeing a lot of positive signs. You know, our overall pipeline is at its highest in the last 2 years. Our order book is also looking much better than what it was last year and also what it was last quarter. So our expectations are very high from the e-learning business. Yes, we made a good start, but we're not done yet. There's a long way to go.
So taking a slightly longer term view, so this business used to be about, I think, 100 crore per year before we acquired.
Correct.
Or before the company actually started facing
Correct.
Problems. So how long do you think we would take to reach that level? So not on this reported basis, but on that original business going to 100 crore level.
2 years.
2 years? Okay, thanks.
Yes.
That's it from us. Thanks.
Thank you.
Mr. Kulkarni, you're done with your question?
Yes, I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Anup.
Reminder to all the participants, to ask a question, you may please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. We have the next question from the line of Suhas, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hey, Rahul. Great numbers here. I think quarter on quarter, you're going from one high to another. Just wanted to check one thing. You know, I remember last time during COVID time, execution was hit. So just to understand this time, are these numbers despite execution getting hit? Or is there an upside beyond that, you think, coming up in the next quarter? Or, you know, you were able to manage without any hit on the execution front?
No, we haven't had, fortunately, touch wood, fingers crossed, we haven't had any delivery challenges. Yes, you know, again, on the e-learning side of our business, there's still some improvement that could happen, you know, both in operational efficiency and productivity. But that's got nothing to do with the pandemic. It's just a general, you know, we need to improve our operational efficiency in the e-learning business. But the core business, you know, we did not have any challenges this past quarter.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. To ask a question, you're requested to please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of George John from Equity Intelligence. Please go ahead. George John, your line is unmuted. You may please go ahead with your question.
Hi, I hope I'm audible.
Yes, you're audible now.
Could you please share the revenue from the Hivewise business for the quarter?
You know, we don't provide business unit-wise revenue details simply because this is a very competitive marketplace. We do provide business segments, and those results are available with you.
Okay.
So most of the platform business would be Hivewise.
Okay. So is there a sustainable margin that would provide for the e-learning business?
Sorry, for the e-learning business?
Yeah. Sustainable margin.
So first. Yeah, so most companies that do well in this space, you know, operate between 20% and 25% margins, and you know, our first milestone, of course, is going to be to get to that range, 20% to 25%. But you know, MPS is not an average company, so our goal would, of course, be to perform above average. So first milestone is to get to that 20% to 25%, and then of course, once we get there, then you want to beat the average because those seem to be the average industry numbers. There are some changes we have to make to our operating model, and those initiatives are already underway.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. To ask a question, you're requested to please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of Arvindar, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hey Rahul, am I audible?
Mm-hmm. Yes, you're audible.
So congratulations on an excellent set of numbers. Very heartening to see all the efforts that have been put in by the team. So congratulations. So I'd like to understand the supply side situation, right? I know although we do not really operate on the IT side of the business, I just wanted to know if there is any impact to the supply crunch or how is our attrition numbers shaping up?
Sorry, I didn't understand the question again. Could you repeat that, please?
I just like to understand the attrition numbers. How are they shaping up?
Attrition.
So, do you see risk? Yes.
Yeah, so for us, I think last financial year, our attrition numbers were, you know, very low because it was, it was a pandemic year and you know, people were not looking at moving jobs on average. So, last year, we saw very, very little attrition compared to our usual trend. This year, I think the attrition levels have gone back to the pre-COVID years. So we haven't seen attrition go higher than previous. Basically, gone back to the old average and gone back to normal. So for us, it's business as usual. We did see, you know, very little attrition last year, which was out of the ordinary. But this year, it's per expectations.
Okay. So has the compensation cycle complete or is it planned in the next 1 or 2 quarters?
Completed. We complete that in Q1 of every year. So that for us, it was completed in late April, early May, effective April 1st.
Okay. All right. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Arun Shah, an individual investor. Please go ahead. Arun Shah, your line is unmuted. Can you please go ahead with your question?
Hello.
Yes, you're audible, sir. Thank you.
Okay, I'm joining in the call for the first time. So can you just briefly explain me about your two businesses, about e-learning and platform solutions?
Sure. So, our core business, of course, was Content Solutions. We were set up as a Indian subsidiary of Macmillan. And then over the last 7-8 years, the business, and we formed these two new revenue streams. On the platform side, essentially, we own a lot of proprietary IP that we've, got from the Macmillan days. We invested and grew that IP further. After that, we acquired three platform companies, MacPlus, Think, and Highwire Press. And essentially, we provide, platform as a service, which we provide to publishers across the globe. And the platforms basically move, have use cases from content creation to content management to content delivery.
So
we have a full
platform. Only publishers or anyone else also?
So we will, our platform business is largely focused on publishers, but we also have customers as Fortune 500 companies and large corporates, as well as some educational institutions as well. But a large part component of it would be publishers. And then our revenue model is licensing, setup and configuration and implementation. And the recurring charge tends to be about 70% of the annual revenue, and the rest of it is services that we provide on top of the platform.
Correct. And the acquisition of Highwire, which you did, that is a similar
yes.
business, or that is different to your core business which you should do earlier?
So highly complementary. So like MPS was the first content solutions outsourcing company in the world, established in 1970. Highwire Solutions company in the world, established 25 years ago. So highly complementary business, same domain, same marketplace, but it's basically, MPS in the publishing domain was understood to be a content solutions leader, and Highwire was known as the platform solutions leader. So it's been a good combination for us. What we've done after the combination is we've taken some of our platform solutions, and we're now marketing those solutions under the Highwire umbrella brand, which has been very successful for us in the short term. Highwire, of course, has a lot of credibility in the marketplace. Stanford-founded organization, known as a thought leader and known for innovation in the publishing
community. Companies like Stanford is your client, right? Stanford Publishing and all.
I'm sorry?
So Stanford is one of your clients?
No, Stanford University was where Highwire was incubated and founded. They're not a client.
So who's your client? So can you name one of the companies, something, which is your client?
So our top customers would include some of the large publishers like Elsevier, Wiley, Taylor and Francis, but also medium-sized publishers like Royal Society of Chemistry, British Medical Journal, American Chemical Society. So it would basically mostly be public.
Do you manage the websites also, like on the content side?
I'm sorry?
You manage the website also on the content side?
So we provide the platform as a white label, which is the website, and the front end is one component of the platform, but we provide the entire platform ecosystem through which content. So if I am a publisher and my website is called publisher.com, the entire ecosystem that powers publisher.com is provided by us to the publisher.
Correct, got it. Can you just briefly on the e-learning side, what are you doing?
Yeah, on the e-learning side, essentially what we provide is any organization has any large corporate has a learning and development function. The learning and development function is focused on making sure that the employees are going through the typical employee life cycle of selection, recruiting, onboarding, retention, and growth. And what we provide is we provide content and technology solutions that enable that. So, for example, if an organization is looking at an onboarding program, build the content and provide the technology assets to deliver that onboarding program in a digital format. So we power the entire content and technology side of learning and development for corporates on the e-learning side.
Okay. And that's it. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dharmesh Ram from Art Ventures. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening. Congratulations for a good set of numbers. So I think I missed it. What's the size of the order book you are sitting on right now?
Yeah, we don't share business unit-wise information. Just it's a very competitive marketplace. Okay. What I can confirm is that as of last year and you know the previous years, most of our order book on the e-learning side was corporates. But now we are seeing you know a 70-30 split where 30% of our revenue or our order book is from education institutions, which for us is a wonderful development because you know this is an area that we have deep expertise in.
Okay, so one more follow up here. So what's the effective tax rate you are expected for the company going forward? I think I have seen quite a bit of fluctuations out there. And I think this quarter the tax rate was low, and because of that, you know, focus of additional profitability was added to the PAT. So going forward, what base we can take as a tax rate percentage on your PBT?
Yeah, I think last year our tax rates were higher because you know we had gone for you know there were two big events that took place. One, we had gone for a government's scheme called Vivad Se Vishwas. Mm-hmm. To settle an old tax matter that we had, you know, inherited from the Macmillan days, and second, because of the new, you know, because of what's been introduced in the Finance Act on treatment of goodwill, we had to also, you know, have make some changes in our tax working. So last year was an abnormally high tax rate year for us. I think what you're seeing in Q1 is fairly reflective of the path forward. This is going to be our standard tax rate going forward. What you're seeing in Q1.
That's good. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ajay Kapadia from Motilal Oswal. Please go ahead.
Hi, Rahul.
Hi.
Rahul, as you rightly said, that we will compare these results with the fourth quarter rather than the first quarter YOY. I would just like to know, for the whole year, under which segment within the growth would come other than the e-learning platform side. You said that this year would be wait and watch, so I'm assuming right. That the platform side we might not grow, and for the content you have always said that it's like 3-4% you know growth area. So how do you you know look out the how where the growth will come from for this year?
Sure. So I'm not sure if you joined the last call, but I made a correction to that statement on the content side. So like you rightly said, you know, platform business, this is more a wait and watch year because this year we will basically understand what is the true scale of the business because we have a declining business that we are, where we're trying to arrest the decline and we have a growing business, but we don't know how much growth we'll get in the business. So, you know, it should average out and we should see, we'll know more in Q3 and Q4. That's on the platform side. E-learning side, I think, you know, like I was describing at the beginning that, you know, the kind of growth we've seen on the revenue side, you know, we're satisfied, but we're not elated. So we're hoping that through the rest of the year, growth will pick up further than what we saw in Q1. So that's on e-learning. And on the content side, you know, last year we grew at 11-12% and expect that trend to continue this year. So while, you know, if you had asked me the question, you know, if you asked me a question, what is your, you know, vision for the content solution business 2 or 3 years ago, I would have said that, you know, modest growth. But, you know, what the pandemic has done for us in our content business is that it has really differentiated our ability to deliver on schedule, on quality, on budget to our customers. And we have, you know, because of that differentiation point that we've created between us and the other competitors, we are now again bullish about the content business. We expect this to, you know, this trend to continue as our existing customers continue to park more volume with us. And, you know, we're also getting into agreements where customers are not just sharing numbers or volumes for 1 year, but they're also talking about how volumes could grow over a 2-3 year period, particularly on the journal side of our business. So I think this financial year, revenue growth will definitely come more from the content and e-learning business. Having said that, we are expecting significant margin improvement in the platform business as we proceed through the year.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Manjeet from Solidarity Investment. Please go ahead.
Rahul, hi. Thanks for taking time and, you know, great to see the results coming through. I had one question on the e-learning piece. You know, when we reach the scale of 100 crores odd, which you mentioned, what's the kind of margins we would make in this business? And that's more steady state.
Yeah, so,
right? I'm not worried about, you know, next quarter or year.
Yeah, so like I was saying earlier, you know, 20 to 25% is the minimum. An average company in this space makes that kind of margin, an average company. So our first milestone will be to hit, you know, that range sometime by the end of this year. You know, ultimately, when we get to the 100 crore level, we would obviously want the numbers to be closer to 30%, not 25%.
Got it. And
yeah.
Fair enough. My other question was on the e-learning space again. What are the challenges for us to get to that 100 crore mark? You know, whether it's 2 years out, 3 years out, but you know, from a more from a business perspective, you know, what are the challenges the team is facing to get to that mark?
It's a pure sales and marketing challenge, and the reason for that is this business is, large part of the business is project based. So every year, you know, you have to build up an order book from scratch. Yes, you do get some carry through from the previous year, but it's almost like every year you have to build up an order book from scratch. I think it's a pure sales and marketing challenge that we are addressing. You know, on the marketing side, we're definitely seeing much more momentum. And, you know, as Sukwan described in his opening remarks, we want to make sure we carry forward on the momentum. On the sales side, you know, we've now, you know, appointed a chief revenue officer for the MPS Interactive business. This is a person who's already in the business, who's been with the company for, you know, since the late 1990s, since 1997. So he's been appointed chief revenue officer so that, you know, we have one person accountable for revenue growth. And, you know, he's been one of the most successful business development folks in our group since change of ownership from Tata to MPS. And we are also under him adding two sales professionals under him. One in the US and one in potentially in India or the Middle East. So it's a pure sales and marketing challenge. I don't think we have a delivery challenge. It's more on the sales and marketing side. And we're addressing that.
So, and how do we stack up here against our key competitors, you know, in terms of gaps on the sales and marketing side? Are we very close to filling it vis-a-vis them? You know, there's still a lot more to do over there. If you could just give some, you know, industry perspective as well, of us as a competitor here.
You're talking about the e-learning space, right?
Yeah, e-learning, the same space.
Yeah.
On the sales
and marketing. I think what's different between us and our competition is that we have a compact team, but it is a very high performing team. Unlike some of our competitors that, you know, may have a few high performers, some average, some below average. We have a compact, high-performing team, and I think the big challenge ahead of us is how do we scale this team to a bigger size. And as we scale the team, we don't lose, you know, the high-performance culture that we've created in this team. So, so in terms of, you know, marketing, I would say we're now inching ahead of our competition a little bit. Last year, for example, there is awards in learning called Brandon Hall Awards, which are considered to be the Oscars for learning. We were one of the top three companies in terms of number of awards that we received. We received about 34 awards last year in the learning space. So I would believe that on the marketing side, we are now inching competition. And on the side, it's a matter of time, you know, as we add a couple of people and we are, you know, being highly selective on who we add, that we should start seeing results on that front as well.
Great. Rahul, just two more questions and I'll come back in the queue. The first one was...
Sure.
You know, in terms of incentivization of our core team, I'm not sure how we do it, but is it via ESOPs or, you know, it's you know, how do we kind of ensure that, you know, the long-term goals are aligned with the incentivization structure? Some thoughts on that. And the second question was on our core, you know, the traditional business content solution. Do we still see a, you know, low single-digit kind of growth over the next 3 years in this segment, or there could be potentially higher growth in it? Thanks, and I'll come back in the queue, Rahul.
Sure. On the compensation side, we you know, for anyone that can actively contribute to revenue or EPS, you know, they are incentivized to both, you know, fixed compensation and variable compensation. We currently do not have an ESOP scheme, but it's something that is being actively discussed internally. On the content business, you know, like I was describing earlier, if the same question would have been asked of me pre-pandemic, I would have said, you know, this business will probably see, you know, low to mid single digit growth at the best. Having said that, this past, you know, 12 to 18 months have been phenomenal for us on the content side, in the sense that, you know, the strong players in this market have become stronger and the weak players in the market have become weaker, because, you know, on the delivery side, you know, we've been able to deliver a higher volume of work even through the pandemic, and because of that, you know, our customers are viewing us different and also to us, you know, with more emphasis, both in terms of visibility but also in terms of their commitment to us as a supplier. So we are now again 3 years. We are again bullish about content solutions and expect, you know, double-digit growth. So we believe, you know, while earlier we had provided a guidance a couple of years ago that, you know, we will see most of our growth come from the e-learning business, we now believe that we can grow in the content business in the same volumes as the e-learning business.
And this growth on content business, the pricing pressure has eased off, is it? Or it will be a mix of, you know, volumes coming through and pricing pressure still, you know, continuing, which we saw in the last couple of years?
I wouldn't call it pricing pressure. I would call it a pricing gift, in the sense that, you know, pricing for us has always been something that we've used to our advantage. You know, we have, you know, a significant operating model in Dehradun. We have about, you know, close to 1,000 employees there, and, you know, there's a lot more capacity in Dehradun. Secondly, you know, we take a lot of pride in automating things on the content side, whether it's things to do with workflow or to do things with mechanical, we tend to automate them. So between automation and our Dehradun model, you know, we use pricing, you know, downward pricing as an advantage. And yes, you know, prices will continue to go down, but it will also mean increase in volumes. And overall, you know, we are confident that, you know, in the revenue equation of P into Q, as P reduces, Q will increase at a faster clip. So we've done all the math around that and the forecasting around that, and when we are you know, managing these agreements with our customers, and yes, it could mean pressure for the industry in general, but for MPS, from an MPS perspective, you know, we're using it as an advantage.
Thanks a lot, Rahul.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jyoti Singh from Arihant Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening, Rahul, and congrats on the good set of number. I just wanted to understand the education platform opportunity and what is the size of the opportunity. If you can.
Thank you for your question.
Yeah,
I think so from a platform side of our business, you know, we find it very, there's not much research out there on the publishing platform landscape. What we do know is that, you know, we have, you know, our platform ecosystem is broken into various parts. So there's a content distribution and delivery ecosystem. There's an analytics ecosystem. There is, you know, content authoring and content creation ecosystem. Then there's a content workflow and content management ecosystem. And while we don't know what, you know, each of these modules or each of these sub-markets could be valued at, what we do know is that in each of these modules I described, so there's four or five different modules, our largest competitor has revenues upward north of 50 million in each of the modules. So for every module, we have a unique larger competitor, and each of those competitors have revenues north of $50 million. So, if I were to just add that, the number one player across all the platform ecosystems that we have, you know, their combined revenues would be north of, you know, 300 million. But that's just one competitor. So there's not much research out there that we have access to. Having said that, we are seeing, our incumbent platform business now, platform business minus Hivire now growing in double digits now. So once things do stabilize with Hivire, we expect the comprehensive platform business also to grow at double digits.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Tanay Beda from Right Time Consultancy. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Sir. Congratulations to the management for the great set of numbers. I had a question regarding the business side. So you mentioned having Wiley as a client. So I wanted to understand what kind of service are we providing to a giant like Wiley? And the next question is, from this academic year onwards, since the universities and classes are going to in-person and switching from online, so would we be seeing any negative impact due to the switch from online to in-person? Thanks.
Yeah, so Wiley, of course, is a very strategic customer for MPS. Our relationship goes back over two decades. So it started off with us providing content management services for their journals business and their books business as well. So we engage with them on the content solution side. Prior to the acquisition of Hivire, we were providing Wiley with some platforms on the content management side as well. And then after the acquisition of Hivire, our relationship has grown even further because we two of the Wiley products that are significant in revenue are managed and hosted by us. So it's a fairly comprehensive relationship. The only area of business that we do not engage with Wiley today is on the e-learning side, and that's also something that we're trying to nurture and develop. Currently, we are mostly on the content and platform side of the business. And again, the vision, of course, for us with some of our strategic customers is to really be truly end-to-end and engage with them across our various lines of business. So that's one of our big goals over the next couple of years, to be able to navigate that. Could you repeat your second question, and I can answer that.
Yeah, sure. So from this academic year onwards, most of the universities and schools in the US are switching to in-person from online. So would we be seeing any negative impact due to that shift?
No, we don't see any negative impact. If anything, there may be some positive impact because, on the education publishing side, any revenue that might have been, that's a customer selling to universities, any revenue that may have been impacted because of people being at home, those products will come back into action. Additionally, most publishers and institutions have moved to digital first workflows. So they produce the digital version first and then the print version. Everything has a digital version today. So we don't see any impact on people going back into the physical infrastructure impacting our business in any way.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Reminder to all the participants to ask a question. You may please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of Sachit Motwani from Param Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, Rahul. Congrats on a great set of numbers. My question was on, now you're sitting on 227 crores of cash. In the past you've made acquisitions where either the revenues are not growing or declining and you get them at a reasonable valuation. But any thoughts on incremental acquisition, any change in strategy in terms of trying to acquire a company which is growing and might as well pay a better valuation? Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, so great question. Thanks, Ajit. So there's two aspects to this question. I think on the acquisition side, the only big change in strategy that's taken place is, we recognize that, whether it's a company that has 3 million in revenues or 20 million in revenues, for us as a management team, it takes the same amount of effort. So what we have kind of taken a call is that we want to definitely, look at acquisitions that are, upward of $10 million in revenues because they end up being more meaningful. Having said that, if there's something below $10 million that is opportunistic and helps us complete some capability area that's missing, we would make that play, but that's not something that we're actively pursuing. But even in that play, we would at least look at, you know, revenues of at least 5 million at the least. So that's one change in strategy in terms of we want to take a meaningful bite versus, you know, just doing very, very tiny acquisitions like we did between, you know, in the early days. Mm-hmm. In terms of, an acquisition that's of a business that's growing versus declining, yes, we are having those type of conversations, but, you know, we're looking to structure them slightly differently, where, you know, we may not just do the acquisition outright as a 100% cash type of acquisition upfront. So those are conversations that we are pursuing, particularly on the e-learning side of our business, because most of the companies in this space are growing, and this is an area that we want to grow as well. So yes, absolutely, we're looking at those type of companies, but we're not looking at a big bang approach there. We're looking at more like a possibly a phased approach or other approaches that we are, you know, contemplating. And then the second part of your question, of course, on the which you didn't ask, but I'll still share the information that, you know, we are also, our board will in next quarter be, sharing a dividend distribution policy. So we will be, you know, creating a public document that gives access to what our policy is in a more transparent manner. Of course, you know, we will also be evaluating if there's any excess cash at the end of the year, what is the most efficient form of that distribution, whether it is dividend or buyback.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Rahul.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Mohit Rathi, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. I have two questions. First of all, congratulations on a good set of results.
Thank you.
So on the last call, there was that we are going to put a lot of impetus on reviving the high wire business. But still, I think the platform business is on a decline. So what is our initiative on, you know, bringing it back and stabilizing it somewhere? And second is on the, you just mentioned on the dividend or buyback. So last year we did a buyback at around 600 and company has done well. So why don't we look into another buyback?
Sure. So I'll take the first question. On the platform side, we must appreciate that we acquired a business that was declining and a loss-making business. So our first goal really has been to arrest the decline and to, you know, stop the bleeding and make the business profitable. We've been able to successfully turn around things on profitability very quickly. In fact, under MPS ownership, Highwire has not had a single loss-making month. From the first month itself, we were profitable. So for us, you know, it was a proud moment that most recent acquisition, we've actually gotten things right from the first month itself. On the revenue side, in terms of arresting the decline, you know, we've understood that many of the issues that the Highwire customers were facing were on the support side, and that had to do more with a capacity problem. We've managed for that by increasing capacity and support in India. We now have 50 employees that are attached to the Highwire business in India. When we bought Highwire, their total headcount was between 75 and 80. So just the India team today is 90 people. So we've significantly scaled the support function as well as the operations function in general. Many customers are starting to see signs of that. Just to give you one data point, when we bought the company, our total number of support tickets were hovering between 400 and 500 for the Highwire group. Today, as I speak, they're less than 200. So we've been able to significantly reduce the tickets, and customers are seeing that kind of, you know, lift. One of the things we obviously cannot control is any customer that decided to terminate the agreement with Highwire prior to acquisition. We've not been able to, you know, turn that around, because normally with a platform supplier, customers only terminate an agreement when things have become, you know, really bad. So it's very difficult to recover. Having said that, we did have at least half a dozen customers that were kind of on the fence. They did not terminate, but they were not happy. and each of whom we've either been able to renew or upgrade through additional offerings. So we started to correct for that. How that plays out in terms of, you know, has Hivewire hit bottom, or has, you know, MPS, the core MPS platform business, has it hit its peak? All of that will now play out through the year. It's very difficult to predict how it will play out. But overall, what we expect is that at a consolidated level, we'll achieve a base. And from that base, we should be able to grow, you know, at 10-15%, you know, fairly comfortably. On the, you know, on the dividend buyback question, really, my understanding is that, you know, two sequential buybacks based on the regulations need to have a 12-month gap. We have not clocked out of the previous 12 months yet. We're still in the 12-month window. So of course, you know, in the next board meeting, we will be, as I described on the previous question, we will be announcing a dividend distribution policy. And, you know, depending on when the buyback opportunity becomes available based on the law, rules and regulations, of course, we will be pursuing that based on where we are with the funds, surplus funds at that time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Reminder to the participants to ask a question, you may please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of Dhruv Shah from Ambika Fincap. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi Rahul. Congratulations on a good set of numbers. I just had one question. You said that you don't give guidance, but considering the growth you have shown in e-learning and you're saying that content solutions growth is also coming back, can we expect mid double digits growth in this year, and then next year maybe platform solutions coming back with Hivewire contributing? So can we expect more than 20% growth? Just a rough guidance would be.
I can give you some data that might help you arrive at your numbers. But, you know, of course, we won't give you, you know, we won't spoon feed you guidance. Right. So that's, you know, in that, because in the past when you've done that, in fact, we see that, you know, when we share guidance, we limit ourselves and we set a ceiling on our aspirations, because, you know, once you have a guidance, you try and hit the number, not beat the number. So we don't want any ceiling to our aspirations. In terms of some data points, as I described to Anoop from Pinebridge earlier on the call, that our e-learning business, we want to get to 100 crores in a couple of years, which means this financial, by the end of this financial year, next financial year, our goal will be to get to that scale. So you can do some math on the e-learning side. On our content solutions business, we should grow at the same clip of, you know, 10, 11, 12, 13% for the next 2 to 3 years. We expect that. And then once the platform business stabilizes through the end of the year, we can expect, you know, 10 to 15% growth in the platform business. I hope that helps you.
Yeah, but Rahul, my question was e-learning, you were any which way at a run rate of 88 crores. So isn't 100 crores a bit less of the...
Yeah, I think you're looking at the... let me clarify that. You're looking at the combined e-learning business, which includes TopSim, Switzerland, and India e-learning. So to just give you some sense, this we are talking about only about the India entity to go to 100 crores. And the combined values and the corresponding combined value that we're talking about is more like 130 crores. So if you take the TopSim and the Switzerland revenue and, you know, and add them to the 100, it will probably come to 130 crores.
Right. And also on the EBITDA margin side, you have shown a tremendous improvement in your e-learning side. So can we cross 30%, and is 30% plus kind of sustainable?
Yeah, I think the first goal for us in e-learning is to you know, and I'm talking PBT, by the way, I'm not talking EBITDA, because, you know, one of the things that this new Ind AS has done, which I still as a business person, I'm not an accountant, I don't understand, is, you know, they move parts of rent into depreciation. For the life of me, I can't understand. So we've in fact stopped looking at EBITDA. We now look at PBT as a management team, because that whole rent equation moving to depreciation confuses the hell out of us. So the numbers I am talking about are PBT, not EBITDA. So we're talking about, you know, the first goal is to get to 20 to 25%, that average range. And then once we get there, then reassemble, reassess, regroup, and then try and see what we need to do to hit the 30. We're not close to the 20-25% range yet. So we want to hit that number first.
Right. No, I was talking on the console part.
Yeah, on the console part, I think, the other part of it is our content solutions business also is not where it needs to be on the margins front, because, you know, we are expecting some growth at the end of this year on our journals business. So you'll see, you know, some of our, you know, we've increased headcount there. That headcount is currently not being built. Once it starts getting built, those margins will improve. In the journals business, you have to prepare headcount, you know, 3-4 months ahead of the work coming. That's just how the journal business works. And when once the revenue comes, then you get good margins. Console level 30% should be a fairly achievable milestone, assuming, you know, we exceed 40% on the platform business soon enough, and we get back to the mid 30s in content business and the e-learning between 20 and 25. So yeah, 30% should be fairly achievable.
Okay. Thank you so much and all the best.
Thank you.
Reminder to the participants, to ask a question, please press star and one. As there are no further questions from the participants, I now hand the contents over to Rahul Arora for his closing comments. Over to you, sir.
Thank you again, a big thank you and lots of gratitude for everyone for all the support through our journey. As I shared at the top of the call, MPS has generally entered now what we can call a thriving phase. Q1 has been an exceptional quarter, both on revenue and profit terms. And, you know, we hope to carry forward the momentum through the year and look forward to all your support and continued guidance. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, members of the management. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of MPS Limited, that concludes this conference call. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.